Hi, I'm Fred McNeil, and you're watching QACTV7. You're watching a show called Conversations with Fred, and thank you for watching it today. Every week, we have different people from the community come in and talk about what their job is, how they can help you, and you get to know them a little bit, okay? Today, we're having a person on the program. I've known the family for years, right? She fed over, 150,000, 200,000 people last year. Amanda, thank you for coming on. When I got up this morning, it was 32 degrees. I don't think it's warmed up a lot.
It has not warmed up out there.
Amanda, tell everybody who you are, where you're from, and what you do at the Board of Ed.
Sure. All right. Well, Fred, thanks for having me today.
Thank you for coming.
I am Amanda Ensor. I have been an educator in Queen Anne's County for almost 20 years now.
Oh, so you're in the home stretch here.
Seems like a long
congratulations.
Time. Thank you. So I spent 15 years as a classroom teacher.
Okay.
The last 10 as a fourth grade teacher.
Where were you teaching?
Well, I started at Bayside Elementary.
Okay.
And then made my way up to the northern part of the county.
Okay. So you've been all over the county.
All over.
Good for you.
And finished out in the classroom at Churchill Elementary
all right.
School. And now I am in a new role and have been in this new role for the last 4 years. As the official wordy title is Family Engagement Specialist.
What does that mean?
Yes, exactly. I think now in my fourth year, I finally kind of know what this job means.
Did your boss know?
Bit.
That's all
That's
I want to know.
That's a good question. But it is honestly, my role is to build a strong, intentional, authentic partnership between families at home and school.
Okay.
And so that can be it happens in many capacities, right?
How?
So it can be as something as a child needs a particular thing, for example, a winter coat.
Okay.
I'm helping families do that. But on the other side of that, also really working with our educators on how to better collaborate, connect, and listen and work with their families.
With their parents.
Mm-hmm.
And we just had a guest on before you who was talking about the town of Centerville has to do that. Communications is a key, Board of Ed, town commissioner, whatever it is. And we all have to improve on it. You guys are doing a great job.
We're trying.
We can always get better.
And one of the things we're really working on is kind of removing that word communication and talking about connection.
Okay.
So really, really, really connecting.
Good.
I'm trying to sort of brand Queen Anne's County's definition or public school's definition of family, and family being all the important people in a child's life.
And that's grandparents,
anyone,
parents, anybody in the house.
Anybody who is important in that child's life. And so really, really connecting all of them. So we're working for the best interest of the child.
Now, are you working through the principals? Or are you actually, like when someone's watching the show, Amanda will get the kid a coat? or you work through the principal? How's it work?
So it works in a variety of ways, actually. Mm-hmm. I'm officially tied to our Title I schools.
Okay.
Which is
remind everybody what Title I is.
Title I is really defined nationally as a school that has 40% or more children who receive free and reduced meals.
Okay, now how many Title I schools would we have
so
in Queen Anne's County?
So Queen Anne's County has four Title I schools.
Three elementaries.
Churchill, Southersville, and Graysonville.
Okay, and that means 40% of the population is getting free and reduced meals
correct,
at those schools. Okay.
Correct. And then Southersville Middle School.
Oh, Southersville Middle, okay.
Yes, which is the feeder school for Churchill and Southersville. So it makes sense.
Now, if you say you're a Title I school, you've been labeled it, does that mean grants or does it mean money? Or what
oh,
is that?
Absolutely.
Oh,
so
help
it
us
is,
out. Yeah.
So you are designated a pretty large sum or allocated money every
this
year.
This is from the feds.
From the feds, and it comes down through the state and all those, all those, you know, avenues.
All the bureaucrats are doing their job.
Exactly.
Sure.
And that money is designated to really meet the needs of all students. So once a school is labeled a school-wide Title I school.
So the whole school is covered.
The whole school is covered. All families, all educators, all students, you name it, everybody falls into that in that community.
Now,
support.
Give me some specifics. So someone's watching this saying, hey, that makes sense. We've got four schools. They need a little help. We're getting 40% of the population with free and reduced meals. So how, but give me some particulars, how do they help? Do they help with meals? Do they help with clothes? How do we help?
No, mostly it's linked to student achievement and social emotional
helping them
health.
In the classroom.
Yep.
Okay.
Or, you know, within the building. Also a big part of it, and it's the reason why I'm tied to Title I schools, is family engagement. By law, Title I schools have to do, I mean, we should all be doing this, really work diligently to create an environment in our school, a culture in our school that is welcoming to families, that works side by side with families, that allows families to be part of the decision making.
How do we do that?
Oh, gosh.
I mean, it's the COVID, I mean, first of all, I mean, I don't know how you educators made it last year. I mean, my wife retired. I mean, she was an AP history teacher, had it made. She said, Fred, This things have changed too much between attendance. How in the world did you all get through last year?
So I like there's a lot of silver linings, okay?
Tell us.
And I think now that
I need silver linings.
You do need silver linings, because a lot of times media, everything else that we read gets sort of hung up on the learning loss and this and all that this
and
happened.
And the kids are fighting in school and the kids can't it's a bunch of baloney probably.
Well, you know, everybody's adjusting back to social environments.
Yeah.
Right? This is a major adjustment period. One of the biggest and best things I think that happened last year, because we went to that remote learning setting, our educators were physically in or virtually in the homes of many of
our
students.
In the house on a computer, and the whole family
and
could watch.
And vice versa, families were really paying close attention to what was happening in the classrooms. And so all of a sudden, we were more connected than we had ever been before.
Good. So that was a plus.
I think
Keep giving me the pluses. Okay.
Now, are we recovering from that a little bit now that we're back in our brick and mortar, you know, we're back in school? And yes, but I think at the same time, it opened a lot of our educators' eyes on the power of connecting and even...
So you think it helped us as educators?
I do.
Good.
I do. I think it gave, you know, sometimes we are very siloed into what we see in our classrooms.
Yeah. If it didn't happen in room 226, it didn't happen.
It doesn't happen. Yeah, right. Yeah. And for students too, you know, teachers don't leave room 226. No, they sleep there. They eat there.
That's where they live.
That's where they live. So I constantly look for that, and a lot of it has to do with the language. Like, I'm like, stop saying learning loss, stop saying these things. Let's just talk about moving forward, right?
Okay.
Instead of looking back.
Are we moving forward, do you think, now that we're back?
Yes.
Are we making this tough?
We are. I think that sometimes the adults in the situation forget how resilient our children are.
Well, I think, and again, excuse me for interrupting you, I think all the terrible things that happened with the pandemic, and they're still happening, the kids are back, right? I mean, we've got volleyball playoffs, we've got football playoffs, we have kids wanting to do this, wanting to do that. Like you said, the parents and adults somehow.
Well, and we are reaching and reaching hard for anything that feels like what we knew, I guess.
Okay.
I like to also say, like, let's not refer to getting back to normal, because this is not, we're not, normal's not.
There never been.
It doesn't exist, right? So this is, we're moving on to what's next.
Okay, as Queen Anne's County, you think, now, opinion, have we returned, we won't use the word to normal, but are we operating as a successful school system?
We are definitely trying.
Oh, good.
We are definitely
trying. Okay.
Yep,
good.
And that's, you know, 100%
where can we,
effort.
What do you see, where can we improve? I mean, front page, is it the New York Times, the Washington Post? This week, fights in schools is just going crazy because children, unfortunately, I used to be in home, looking at a computer. Now they get bumped into the cafe. I mean, are we doing all right with that in Queen Anne's County?
We are, and we really are trying to emphasize or at least put in additional supports for that social-emotional recovery.
Okay.
Because that is where, and I think honestly, you know, rather than focusing on academics in many, we've just got to help these kids figure out how to be physically near one another again, right?
Well, I have a member of the family's a phys ed teacher and said, Dad, they've got how to line up.
Yep.
They've got how to play duck, duck, goose.
Yep.
And the little X's on the gym floor where they used to know to line up, what are your X's on the floor?
Right.
How are you helping teachers cope with kids who've been out of school for what, X number of months?
It's tough, and teachers are tired. I mean,
it's exhausting
because you're dealing with more behavioral things that we're not necessarily trained officially by nature, but at the same time, you know, everybody is transitioning. And so, you know, I think we need time.
Okay.
We need patience.
Okay, as long as the pandemic was or is, we need that equal amount of time on the other side, don't you think?
I think, absolutely.
To adjust to the new...
Yes, and the other thing, too, is we could really use a lot more empathy.
Okay, and explain that a little bit. Empathy is a great way. You're talking from adults in the community.
All partners, right?
Okay.
As educational jargon, they say all stakeholders, right?
Okay.
Anybody
okay.
who is somehow connected, all those important people, as we need time. And we need to be empathetic of one another.
Okay.
You know, I like to remind our teachers, you know, we're grieving, right? We're going through these seven stages of grief because we've lost what we thought was teaching.
Yeah.
This is different.
Well, look at the number of people my age who still, unfortunately, nobody my age is, but senior teachers, you're right, because they're doing, and they're using, unfortunately, the word normal, it ain't ever happening again.
Yeah.
And it's a big adjustment, right. Yes?
And you're going through, you know, grief. What do you go through? You're sad, you're angry, you're, you know, it's all those stages, and we need to allow all of us to go through those on our own time.
Are we spending time with in-service training? I mean, is that, do in-service now, where it used to be, where I'd learn new games as a phys ed teacher or new lab procedures, are we helping teachers deal with that?
Yeah, so part of, I mean, part of my focus, and part of my job is providing that professional learning to teachers. And what I really am tasked to do is to look at the individual needs of our school communities and say, okay, this is what this group of teachers needs the most. So for example, last week on our professional development day, I did a training with the Southersville Middle School teachers on what I call the power of YET, the best practices for engaging our EL, which stands for English learner, or immigrant families. And so it was a reminder of here are some best strategies, and here's the mindset we need to embrace when we are working with our English learner
population. I'm gonna come back to, is the pandemic, do you think, particularly hard on Title I schools and our immigrant community, or across the board it was just tough for,
it was tough for everyone. Now, here's what I learned in trying to meet basic needs across the county for those months, is that Title I communities were, as usual, quick to grab on to what they know as their lifelines, their schools, their hubs.
Okay, so they came to their rescue, as you did with the food, for example.
And and I mean, and whatever was needed, and they were willing to reach out. They showed up, and you know, there was no hesitation in that.
So they knew the school and education facilities or staff would help in some.
Yep, and it would be, you know, get a phone call or a WhatsApp message or whatever it was about. Even just, what am I supposed to do? Somebody in my house has COVID. What do I do? You know, I mean, they really hold on.
And they
to schools.
Called the schools.
They
Terrific.
Hold on to schools. What I found at, you know, across the district, in some of the schools in the southern end, is that we weren't used to needing the schools for so much.
And we're talking the
Kent
southern end of Kent.
Yeah, okay. All, you know, kind of
no Title I schools down there, right?
Graysonville. Yes.
Okay, Graysonville.
But past that, no. And so that was definitely a learning curve. Now wait a minute. The schools are providing food. We're providing the services. We're still trying to keep connected and keeping tabs on all of our students. And I think that was a bit of a learning curve for those schools and communities. Okay, wait a minute. We do need these schools.
Oh, good. Good. Yeah. Now, do you feel at this point, here we are, November of 2021, do you think most of the professional education staff were kind of, we're back? Does that make sense?
Yeah.
I mean, is that fair to say? I mean, I wouldn't be, I don't know how you all handle it. I mean, my wife would come home, Fred, they changed the attendance policy, they changed the grading policy. I don't know how people stayed in the career with all the changes going on. And it looks like to me, most people are back, most people are adjusting.
They are, because I think the thing that helped everybody the most was when they saw kids in person.
Good. And kids are resilient.
In real life.
Yes.
And, you know, as physical distancing, whatever, but if a kindergarten child comes and hugs you,
you're going to help them.
Hey, I'm here. I'm back. This is what I'm here for. Now, that's not to say that educators are not taking on 65 more roles. Oh, we are being counselors, and we're still meeting basic needs, and there's, I mean, all of these.
Well, the COVID question, do I get a shot, do I don't get a shot? I mean, I'm
just
sure
in general,
teachers are getting asked these things. I mean, when people are watching this, if a company is watching this and saying, you know, I'd like to help, how can the public help you do what you're doing? I mean, can they donate pencils or coats or what?
Oh yeah, absolutely. So part of my job also is community partnerships.
Okay, how we get involved?
Well, man, it looks like all kinds of different things. So, but it could be something as little as a pencil. It could be supporting.
So if I own a company like Gary Hoffman, the sheriff's department, they give us boxes of pencils to give out to kids walking the trail. So if I own a small business that has so-and-so, they could give you a case of pencils and you take them.
Oh, for sure.
Now, how do they do that? Do they call?
Call me. Contact me.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, absolutely.
How do they get in touch with you?
So you can contact me at my QACPS email, amanda.ensor@qacps.org.
Okay.
Or I always give out my cell phone number, too. So there's, really.
And if all comes, they're not sure what to do, they can call Jeff Strait at the Board of Ed, 410-758-2403, extension 148, and say, Jeff, how do I get in touch with them? What do you need? Do you need jackets, pencils, food?
Well, we are moving into colder weather. So I've gotten a couple requests in the last week for winter coats. That is something that comes up.
Now, do you want new ones or can they be used ones or what?
So kids are kids, right? They like new stuff.
Okay.
So I'm not incredibly picky, but ideally, this is what I say, you know, we love new books.
Okay.
Putting a new book in a child's hands.
Any particular type of book?
I mean,
something they can read, something they get at the library, that type of thing,
yeah.
As opposed to a math book or an English book.
Correct,
that's separate,
right. Fiction, you know, stories, but something that they can call their own, brand new, right?
That's well, jackets, we can appeal to the public here. I mean, there's a need.
Winter coats is a big deal.
Do we need hundreds of those or 20 of those?
Like I said, we had our first cold week, right, this week. So I'm just starting to get the trickling in of emails about winter jackets.
Okay.
So that is definitely a need.
So, please, if you're out there and you would like to contribute something like a jacket or jackets, right, you'd certainly be delighted with that.
Yeah.
How about, so small business, maybe pencils, that type of thing, jackets. Anything else on your list of...
A lot of times, so, you know, the one thing about Title I spending is it's very restricted.
Right,
you know, it has to be allowable, necessary, all those things that we go through with federal dollars.
What the feds tell you to do.
And so I do have money that is allocated specifically for family engagement or community engagement, but sometimes I can't do things like buy a dinner to serve at that because it's not an allowable expense.
Okay.
So I always am looking for community partners to sponsor that type of thing.
Now, when you say a dinner, specific food or...
A
pass to go to a restaurant? Or
no, an example, we had one of the things I can say that families are grabbing onto, and it's educators too, is the opportunity to get back to some of these events at school. Now we're doing them outside to meet safety guidelines, et cetera. It's
getting colder. Give me what type of event?
I was gonna say, so one of this community partnership, real successful events we recently had was at Graysonville Elementary School.
Okay.
I have a program called Dudes in Schools.
What's it again?
Dudes,
okay, in school, okay.
Yes, and it is a father figure mentoring program.
It's an
opportunity to kind of overcome that typical gender imbalance in school and create volunteers.
The moms are there, but not us dads, right?
Yeah, I mean, it's a historical gender imbalance.
Sure.
It's a systemic structure we've created without even knowing that we've done it.
Yeah.
And it's not to say that we're not so grateful for our moms, but also some of our father figures.
I have a neighbor, they have a dance at Centerville Elementary. That's a highlight of his year when he takes his daughter to the dance. Because he works, bless his heart, 12 hours a day. But I don't care what's going on, that dance is special for daughter and dad.
So I'm not sure if you saw recently on, I think it was CBS featured a story about the Louisiana Dads on Patrol.
Oh no, tell us about
it. They're having these dads at some high schools that were having some significant behavior issues, just kind of be visible in the hallway.
Walk the hallways,
mentors.
I like that.
So my dudes in school, actually, and they did this last year pre-COVID, we used to say connecting with kids one high five at a time.
Oh, wow.
But now we've gone to fist bumps because we can't, high five anymore. But my dudes in school, one of the things that they do, because when the kids get off the bus at Graysonville Elementary School, we call them the hype men.
Okay.
They stand outside as the kids
wave
come off the bus, wave, smile, fist bump on their way into school.
These
are all father figures or
terrific.
Dads. They held an event for over 300 families at Graysonville.
Terrific.
Playing football, soccer.
Oh, wow.
They donated fishing rods, taught them how to cast. So
a fun event.
Yes, but those were all community. I mean, they went to their businesses and donated a lot of the things for that type of event to happen.
So if a business says, you know what, and this is again related to your Title I schools.
Yeah.
The schools you mentioned, do me a favor, say the four schools one more time.
So Churchill Elementary, Sellersville Elementary.
Okay.
Graysonville Elementary and Sellersville Middle School.
If you're a business in that area or a business anywhere, if you'd like to contribute food or some type of financial aid? Is that possible?
We can make that, yeah.
Contact you and it would help children, right?
Absolutely. It goes directly to them.
I mean, a lot of businesses are just sitting there, how can I help? I mean, they get tired of the people knocking on the door, but you know, no one turns down a school system.
In my years
as a teacher, you could ask for anything and the great community would come to your rescue.
Yeah, and you know, we're a small town, right? So many of them have family in our schools.
The kids go to the school.
Yeah.
And again, just dial 758-2403, ask for Amanda Ensor.
I have an extension at the board now.
Please.
Extension 114.
So. All right. By the way, I don't know how I got you on the extension
okay.
the other day. I still can't figure that out. All right. So call the Board of Ed main number.
Yeah.
Get your extension 114 and say, look, I would like to help you with one of these events, either financially or maybe with food or whatever.
That'd be great.
Now, we've only got a couple minutes, but I got to ask you, How in the world, we're going to change subjects here.
Okay.
How many people, the public needs to know, how many people were you involved with directing it, basically? People did you feed last year? I mean, I saw a figure at 150,000. I'm sure it was bigger than that.
It was bigger in the end, and I don't the exact number, but it was a remarkable.
I mean, hundreds of thousands, right?
Yeah.
Oh, it was amazing, and that was a community effort.
Yeah, it was. I mean, it was initially again calling on our schools as our hubs,
right?
Because it's a safe location.
And bus drivers and teachers and principals.
Bus drivers, teachers, and then you know, getting meal services and donations, and it was just a mass operation.
It was amazing. You call me up, Fred. There's milk in fill in the blank. Fred, there's potatoes somewhere else. And bless their hearts, the people would show up, and they were so very thankful.
Yep.
And we were delivering food to places I didn't realize.
We're part of Queen Anne's County.
No, I'm still convinced I hit a time zone.
Yes.
But then that was all through our school system, right? That's your tax dollars helping us out in private donations.
Absolutely. I said I did more with milk last year than I ever probably want to do again.
I never want to look at it again.
We had like 2,000 gallons of milk to give away. It's just, you know, and it was incredible. And there, again, another silver lining, right? Meeting and working with members of this community that I had never met, didn't know existed.
No.
Finding niches and places in the community.
People who lived in places, like you said, I'm not going to mention the names, but I just didn't realize we were in the county, especially in the upper county.
Yes.
And we also helped the lower county, so people don't realize.
Oh, absolutely. It was definitely countywide, but when you get up to some of these rural areas, you have no idea what exists down that road.
Okay. Now, we've got a minute left here. So how's the family doing? You've got someone in ninth grade now.
Yes.
You've got someone in sixth grade.
I do.
Your husband's staying out of trouble.
He is, mostly.
The Ensor family all doing well?
Everyone's doing well.
Okay.
Yes.
And the program wasn't bad, was it?
No.
Would you do me a favor? All the people hiding from me on this, including my daughter-in-law,
on
the second floor, would you say, come on,
I will.
Well, look, thank you for coming on. Good luck with all this. And again, that's just remind the public, if you want to help out with a Title I school, whether it's a box of pencils, whether it's six pencils, a cash donation, food donation, and particularly as the weather gets chilly, coats would be nice to know.
Yes, hats, coats.
Call you at the Board of Ed, all right, 410-758-2403. Just ask for Mrs. Ensor, and they'll direct you to, and they'll tell you, do you pick up things, or they drop them off at school?
Oh, yeah, no, I'm all over the place. So
okay.
We'll make
and you don't
it
mind
work.
Doing that?
Nope, not at all. And I want to say, too, even though I'm officially affiliated with Title I schools, mm-hmm. that I'm very well aware of the needs across the community.
So you're not going to turn somebody down.
If someone calls me and wants to contribute specifically to Mattapique Elementary or you know, another school in another part of the county, we have kids all over who need things.
So no matter if it's all the way down in Kent Island,
yep.
or all the way up in Sellersville, if children need something, you'll help them get it.
Absolutely.
You play Santa Claus every day. What a good job. That was a good deal. Thanks for being on the show.
Thanks
for
having
me.
I appreciate it.
And like I said, I'm going to say it again. Tell you on the second floor. You can't hide. Fred's going to look for you.
All right.
I'm Fred McNeil. Thank you for watching our show. My time's up. Thank you for your time. We're going to see you next time.